Yo, good morning. Welcome to the gathering. It's good to see you. Would you stand with us as you're able?
We shout it out, we're alive, 'cause you're alive. Good morning. It is a joy to be in worship together this Sunday morning, to share in this time with one another. I want to welcome all the folks that are worshiping with us online. I invite you to register your attendance with us on our website so that we can know that you are worshiping with us today. I want to lift up a few announcements that we have this morning. Next Sunday, we are going to have a church rafting trip on the Hiwassee River. Anybody that's interested can rent their raft at Hiwassee Outfitters or Webb Brothers Float Service. And you can meet us at the river at 1:30. Pick the 2 o'clock time slot. We're really excited to be able to go down the river together. Love to have you come to that. Also, this Wednesday, we are continuing our study on the different Christian denominations. We've been doing this for a couple months now. Really, really enjoyed this. It's going to be at 7 o'clock in Ensminger Hall, or you can join us online. This week, we are going to be studying the Unitarian Universalist denomination. So come and learn more about that. We'd love to have you. We are also offering a Keith 101 class. This is a class for new members or anyone who's interested in learning more about our church. We'd love to have you come. That's going to be every Sunday during the month of August from 10 to 10:45 in the conference room. So we'd love to have you come and learn more about our church. If you're visiting with us this morning, we're so glad that you are here. I invite you to come again next week and worship with us. We've got coffee and chai tea over here. You're welcome to fill your cup and enjoy our time of worship this morning. So let us now go to the Lord in prayer. O living Christ, you changed Cana's water into festive wine. Transform our common worship into celebration, that we may taste your glory here and now, and anticipate that heavenly banquet where we shall behold your face forever. Amen.
Would you stand with us as you're able? Search the world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise, the treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. Satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of to dancing. You You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. And oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
Grab a seat this morning.
We now come to our prayer time this morning, and it is certainly a joy to have Josh and Cecia back after their trip to Honduras. Glad that they had a wonderful time, and glad to have Josh back leading us in worship again. But thankful to have them this morning. This morning, it's also a joy to lift up Matthew Crabtree, who's been our organist for a number of years. We're excited for him. He has now taken a position at St. Paul's Episcopal Church. It's kind of a joy and a concern for us. We're thankful that he has that opportunity to move forward and to share at St. Paul's as their organist. We're going to miss him as our organist, but we are going to celebrate him next Sunday. That will be his last Sunday, kind of in between the services around Sunday school time. So we'd love for you to lift him up and think of him as he moves to that next chapter in his life. It's also a joy. Yesterday, our church held a lemonade stand for Isaiah 117 House, and we raised, I believe it was $1,500 for that organization that helps foster children. And I was told, like, community-wide, between McMinn and Monroe counties, we raised about $102,000 for Isaiah 117 House. So that's a huge, huge blessing. I'm really thankful that we got to be a part of that here in our community. And I want to thank Amelia Reedy for organizing that, Katie Bell, Katie Sumner, a lot of people who came together, Allie Made Cookies, a lot of people who came together behind the scenes to make that happen. I know Rhonda Turner was there as well, but what a blessing that is for our church to be able to participate and be a part of that. Do want to lift up Van Stewart. This is Jeanette Amos's granddaughter, Kelsey Stewart. This is her dad. He has been diagnosed with brain cancer, and so we want to lift him up and remember him. We also want to lift up Alan Boyd. He had a heart attack and had a stent implanted, so we want to pray for his recovery during this time. We also want to lift up Alma Broyles. She's in the hospital right now at Star Regional with dealing with some health issues, and so we want to lift her up during this time as well. Are there other joys or concerns that we can share with one another? Yes, Becky. Amanda's having surgery on her ankle on Wednesday, so we'll pray for surgery to go well and a quick recovery for her. Absolutely. Thank you.
And the book is dedicated to me, so I will autograph that page. And I also have a box on there for
you. All right, sit down. Thank you. All right. Thank you, Allie. Appreciate that. I mean, who doesn't want to buy an Advent book in July, right? Yes, Bill.
Karen
We'll pray for Karen's dad and for God's grace to be made known and to work in that situation in Nashville. Absolutely. Yes, Scott. Tim McPhail, yes, certainly we want to keep lifting Tim McPhail up in our prayers. Yes, Patricia. 37 years of marriage on Tuesday for Paul and Patricia. Wonderful. Yeah, congratulations. That's wonderful. So, great. Any other joys? It's a joy to have some of my family here this morning. I got my parents, Mark and Janann, my sister, and her husband, Emily and Tim, and their two boys, Ben and Edwin. So glad to have them in worship with us this morning as well. They're sitting there at the back table. So. Do any of us have unspoken requests which we would acknowledge by the lifting of our hands this morning? As always, you can let us know how we can lift you up in prayer. You can email us at prayer@keithumc.org. We'd love to know how we can partner and join you in that. So let us now go to the Lord in prayer. God of overflowing joy, God of wedding parties and new wine, God of love and laughter and dancing and singing, this morning we remember the story of when Jesus turned water into wine at the wedding of Cana. This morning we celebrate together knowing that you are always there to fill us up. Your presence is with us at all times. Oh God, we celebrate the ways in which you are moving and working in our world, bringing forth good fruit, bringing forth good wine. Help us to drink deep of your love and grace and joy this morning. But Lord, we know that there are many who are struggling during this time. There are many who are experiencing pain and grief over the loss of a loved one. There are many who are dealing with various illnesses and diseases and medical issues. There are many who are suffering with anxiety, addiction, and depression. There are many who feel like their cup of joy has run dry. But Lord, we know that when our cups run dry, you are there to replenish us and restore our hearts. Transform us by your Spirit so that we can use our gifts to share about your love with others. May we be empty vessels waiting to be filled by you. May we act as your servants, reaching out to others, working as your hands and feet, doing the things that you have called us to do. Empower us and embolden us as we worship here together this day. And enable us to go forth from this place and to make an impact in people's lives. Change the stagnant water of our lives into new wine that brings forth hope, healing, and joy. Lord, bless this community and bless this church that we might go forth this day to make a difference in people's lives for the kingdom. And as we have offered our prayers, let us also offer our lives, trusting in God's love and call to us, responding with confidence. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. We do have baskets in the back and up here in the front. You're invited to come and bring your offering. And when you do, you can also light a candle in honor or in memory of someone. And you can also come and kneel in prayer. So let us now continue our worship this morning.
Surrender, you are breaking new. ground. So I yield to you into your careful hand. When I trust you, I don't need to understand. So make me a vessel and make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. God, I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. And the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. So make me your vessel, make me an offering, make me whatever you want me to be. God, I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. 'Cause where there is new wine, there is new power, there is new freedom, and the kingdom is here. I lay down my old flames to carry your new fire today. So make me a vessel, make me an offering, make me whatever you want me to be. God, I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me.
This past week, our youth director, Mark Reed, and his wife, Amelia, we're up at Camp Lookout. Mark's been serving as a minister in residence up at camp, which means each morning he would offer a morning devotion to the campers, and the evenings he would offer a little sermon devotion with them as well. It's kind of like the spiritual guide for the week. And so Mark's actually preaching down in the sanctuary this morning. It's been a very busy week for Mark this past week, but I was actually invited to come up on Thursday evening and to share in presiding at the table for Holy Communion. And if you've ever been up to a Camp Lookout before, you might have seen their outdoor worship center. It's a space where they do communion on Thursday evenings. There's a picture of it. Each Thursday during the summer, the campers will light a candle, and they'll walk from the chapel around the lake all the way up to the outdoor worship center. And there we'll share in this time of Holy Communion. It's very moving. It's a very meaningful time. And as I was there this past week, it kind of made me remember a story of when I worked at Camp Lookout. And one night we were sharing in Holy Communion, and my good friend T.J. Burdine, who is a pastor in our conference, was presiding at the communion table. And T.J. was up there, and he was sharing all about the Lord's Supper. He talked about the bread, and then he started to talk about the wine, and he picked up the pitcher, and he was about to pour the juice into the chalice and realized there was no juice. And all the support staff, in a frenzy, just ran off to try to find the bottle of Welch's Finest as quick as they could and bring it back so that we could keep having communion. And TJ stalled, and everything ended up fine. They got a bottle of grape juice, and we continued communion. But as I thought about that story, I couldn't help but think about another story in the Gospel of John. It's a story about when the wine ran out while Jesus was at a wedding in Cana. Scripture lesson this morning comes from John chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the celebration. When the wine ran out, Jesus' mother said to him, "They don't have any wine." Jesus replied, "Woman, what does that have to do with me? My time hasn't yet come." His mother told the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby were six stone water jars used for the Jewish cleansing ritual, each able to hold about 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water," and they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some from them and take it to the head waiter," and they did. The head waiter tasted the water that had become wine. He didn't know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. The head waiter called the groom and said, "Everyone serves the good wine first. They bring out the second-rate wine only when the guests are drinking freely. You kept the good wine until now." This was the first miraculous sign that Jesus did in Cana of Galilee. He revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. After this, Jesus and his mother, his brothers, and his disciples went down to Capernaum and stayed there for a few days. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Jesus is starting to prepare for his ministry. He's gaining a lot of momentum. First, he had encountered John the Baptist, who had paved the way for him, proclaimed Jesus as the Lamb of God who has come to take away the sins of the world. And then Jesus calls two brothers, Andrew and Simon, to come and follow him. And then the next day, he calls two more disciples, Philip and Nathanael, to come and follow him as well. And then comes the third day. And something big happens on the third day. This is the day when Jesus performs his first miracle at the beginning of his ministry. And interestingly enough, later on, Jesus will perform his final miracle at the end of his earthly ministry on the third day. Jesus will rise from the dead on the third day. We can see here at the very beginning, on the third day, Jesus moves and works at the beginning of his ministry and at the end of his earthly ministry. But the story starts off pretty ordinary. Jesus goes to a wedding in Cana with his mother and his new disciples. And you know, weddings in Jesus' day were huge celebrations. They would often last 5 to 7 days. The whole village would usually be in attendance. Everyone would be there having a great time. So I'm sure Jesus was there enjoying the festivities. The disciples were there celebrating along with their new rabbi. Everything is going great. Everything is going great until Jesus' mother comes up to him with this concerned look on her face. And she says, "They don't have any wine." Now, at a Jewish wedding, this is going to be a problem. In fact, in the Talmud, the old rabbis even said, "Without wine, there is no joy." Wine is a big part of the culture. Wine is a big part of the celebration. This celebration is in jeopardy of ending early because the wine has run out. The unnamed bride, the unnamed groom are in danger of cutting their festivities short because without wine, there is no joy. I wonder, have you ever felt like your wine has run out? Have you ever felt like your joy has run out? Have you ever felt like you're just running on empty? There's nothing left in the tank. I think we've all experienced times in our lives where we've struggled, where we've faced challenges. There's times when we feel overwhelmed with all of the things that are on our plates. There are times when we feel like, "I just don't know if I'm going to make it through today. I just don't know if I can make it till tomorrow. How am I going to do this? How am I going to be okay?" Sometimes it feels like our wine has run out. Sometimes it feels like our joy is gone. You know, the wine in this story isn't just wine. Instead, the wine in the story represents joy and life and celebration. And so when the wine runs out, the celebration and the joy is gone. And Jesus knows how important wine is for a celebration. After all, Jesus would go on to participate in a number of feasts and celebrations throughout his ministry. In fact, Jesus' whole ministry is often centered around a table. Jesus eats and drinks with Pharisees, tax collectors, sinners. He eats and drinks with his disciples. We remember the Last Supper when he compares his own body and blood to bread and wine. Jesus eats and drinks so much that he is even accused of being a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Jesus spends so much time in fellowship that he is criticized for it. But community and fellowship, eating around the table, drinking wine, sharing in a meal, these are important aspects of the Jewish faith. So when the wedding runs out of wine, Jesus knows that this is a big deal. But then we see his response to his mother. It's a bit strange. When Jesus' mother comes up to him and says, "They don't have any wine," Jesus curtly replies, "Woman, what does that have to do with me? My time has not yet come." Which is a strange way to respond to your mother. First of all, notice that Jesus' mother never explicitly asked Jesus to do anything about the wine. All she did was she went up to Jesus and simply said, "The wine has run out." She didn't ask him to perform any miracles or any signs or anything. She just simply stated, "They don't have any wine." Second of all, if I called my mom, who's here this morning, woman, things would not end very well for me. Now, you know, I'm sure Jesus didn't mean to be disrespectful. And, you know, if you translated it back into the original Greek, I'm sure, you know, it didn't really sound that bad. But I don't know. I think we can see there's clearly some tension here in this conversation between Jesus and his mother. Regardless, Jesus' mother knows that Jesus has the power to do something about this situation, and we see Jesus is hesitant to do something about it. His time has not yet come. He doesn't want to rush things. We don't really know why. Perhaps this is really not what he had in mind for his first, you know, public miracle. You know, maybe he wanted to do something grander. Maybe he wanted to heal somebody or do something to bring forth a change in someone's life. Or maybe he's realizing that after this miracle, things are going to change. You know, once he starts, pretty soon, he won't be able to stay anonymous and just simply attend a wedding. And once he starts, pretty soon, he won't be able to go anywhere without being bombarded with people requesting healings and miracles and all sorts of miraculous signs. Jesus announces to his mother that performing a miracle right now would be a little bit premature. Now, there's a better place, there's a better time to debut his power and to introduce himself and his power to the people. But Jesus' mother, she does something pretty brilliant here. In response to Jesus' resistance, she turns to the servants and she says to them, "Do whatever he tells you." His mother puts the ball in his court. But she knows what Jesus will do. After all, as a young virgin, she carried Jesus in her belly for 9 months. She gave birth to him in a manger. She raised him to adulthood. She was his mother. She knew who Jesus was, and she knew that Jesus was going to take care of things. Jesus' mother walks off, and now all the servants are looking at Jesus, waiting for their instructions. What is Jesus going to tell them to do? Jesus looks over, and there just so happens to be 6 large stone jars that were used for the Jewish ritual cleansing. Jesus sees these jars. Each of them hold about 20 to 30 gallons. And he orders the servants to fill those jars with water. And they fill it to the brim. And then Jesus says, "Take some out of the jar and take it to the head waiter. Take it to the steward." And so they do. And somewhere in the midst of that process, the water miraculously turns into wine. Now, There's a lot that goes into making wine. First, you have to grow grapes, and there's a lot that goes into that process. You know, weather, the growing season, soil, acidity, time of harvest, the pruning method. Then comes the harvesting, the crushing, the pressing, the fermentation, the clarification, the aging, the bottling. Good wine takes some time. I mean, even bad wine takes some time, right? This is not a quick process. But for Jesus, we see him do this in an instant. Here we see Jesus bypass this long and tedious process, and in an instant, Jesus turns water into wine. And it's not bad wine. It's not watery or weak. It's not sour or bitter. It's good wine. In fact, it's the best wine. It's flavorful and rich and decadent. The head waiter tastes this wine, and he calls the groom over, and he says, "What are you doing? Everybody serves the good wine first. They bring out the second-rate wine after people have been drinking freely. But you've waited to bring the good wine out until now." You know, when I think about that story, I can't help but think again about Jesus gathered together with his disciples for the Last Supper. I love how our communion liturgy puts it. When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." On the third day, Jesus turned water into wine. But Jesus would then go on to take that wine and to change it into something else again. Jesus would take that wine and turn it into the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for me. So perhaps this wedding at Cana, this first miracle of Jesus, was also a foreshadowing of his crucifixion and resurrection to come. In this miracle, Jesus restores the joy. In this miracle, Jesus brings life and vitality and resurrection back into this celebration, just as he does in our own lives. When our wine has run out, Jesus is there to restore our joy. Jesus restores our hope. And I think we have an opportunity to be a part of that for others. We have an opportunity to act like the servants in this story, doing the work that Jesus has called us to do. Like Jesus' mother went to the servants and told them, "Do whatever he tells you." We too can hear that word, that invitation from Jesus' mother. Do whatever Jesus tells you to do. We're called to reach out to others when their wine is running low. We're called to encourage one another, to support one another, to love one another. We're called to reach out to the people in our community that don't have others, those that support around them, those people there to help them. So this morning, how might we perform a miracle and fill somebody's cup up with joy? Let us pray. God of joy and celebration, you are making all things new. Lord, in the pressing and in the crushing, you are making new wine. We pray that you might make us your vessels today to share the joy of your good news with others. Lord, make us a vessel. Make us an offering. Make us whatever you want us to be. Enable us to use our gifts in service to you and to others. In all that we do and on all that we are, may your name be glorified, that your kingdom will be with us and reside here on this earth. We pray all of this in your name. Amen.
Would you stand with us as you're able?
Come, thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of
is praise. Teach me some melodious sound and sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. To grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above. Prone to wonder, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
I want to thank you again for joining us in this time of worship together. I invite you to receive this benediction. Arise and go in peace. May God's love be with you and abide with you now and forevermore. Amen.